The Senate will please come to order. I ask everyone present to rise and recite with me the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. In the absence of clergy, may we all bow our heads in a moment of silence. The reading of the journal, secretary will read.
In Senate Monday, June 28, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Sunday, June 27, was read and approved on motion. Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions. Messages from the Assembly. Messages from the Governor. Reports of standing committees. Reports of select committees. Communication and reports from state officers. Motions and resolutions. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Savino, I wish to call our print number 2311D, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read the title.
Calendar number 196 by Senator Savino, Senate print 2311D, an act to amend the labor law and others.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill was passed.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young, ayes 58.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I now offer the following amendments.
Amendments received.
I believe there are substitutions at the desk. I ask that we make the substitutions at this time.
Secretary will read.
On page 5, Senator Laval moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 6848A and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 3292A, third reading calendar 68. And on page 25, Senator Duane moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 8117B and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 5007A, third reading calendar 900.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, before I proceed...
Substitution order. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, before we proceed, I just want to recognize this is a very special day from one of our colleagues who we hold near and dear. She is someone who I consider a dear friend, and I know all of us. Today is Shirley Huntley's birthday and anniversary.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Senator Huntley, on both the birthday and anniversary. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, at this time I move to recall Senate Resolution number 6298, which was previously adopted. I ask the resolution be read in its entirety and ask that Senator Parker, when he gets here, be allowed to speak on his resolution.
Secretary will read the title slowly so Senator Parker can get it. Oh, it's in its entirety. Secretary will read the resolution in its entirety.
By Senator Parker, Legislative Resolution number 6298, mourning the death of Local 371 President Charles Stephen Ensley, distinguished citizen and devoted member of his community. Whereas, it is the custom of this legislative body to pay tribute to citizens of the state of New York whose life work and civic endeavor serve to enhance the quality of life in their communities in the great state of New York. And whereas Charles Ensley died on Friday, June 18, 2010, at the age of 69. And whereas president of Local 371 for 26 years, Charles Ensley was born in Birmingham, Alabama. He grew up amid the civil rights campaigns of the 1960s, and some of his principles came from his...
Have some order. Secretary will continue to read.
And whereas president of Local 371 for 26 years, Charles Ensley was born in Birmingham, Alabama. He grew up amid the civil rights campaigns of the 1960s, and some of his principles came from his father, John, who in the 1950s led African American workers against brutal opposition in a long battle for equal pay at the Birmingham News. And whereas Charles Ensley had unionism, equality, and integrity in his DNA, growing up in Birmingham as the youngest of four children, he learned the importance of individual goals as well as group goals. And whereas Charles Ensley graduated from Parker High School, at that time the largest black high school in the country, He later went on to attend Howard University in Washington, D.C. And whereas Charles Ensley soon married, and both he and his wife, Annette, moved to New York in 1965, he became a caseworker in the Bureau of Child Welfare, Bedford-Stuyvesant office, and also provided services in tutoring kids in Harlem and educating welfare rights groups. And whereas in 1982, after a hotly contested election with more than 70% of the vote, Charles Ensley became president of Local 371 and began demanding more democracy and financial accountability in the union. And whereas Charles Ensley was an innovative, independent leader with high integrity, possessing an amazing sense of humor and a quick wit, he fought with vigor and intelligence and was proud of winning dignity and job protections for his members and never wavered in his steadfast determination to pursue a progressive agenda. And whereas Charles Ensley believed that diversity is a major source of the strength of the union, regardless of race, gender, blue-collar or professional, the common ground has been defending the rights of every single union member. And whereas under Charles Ensley's leadership as a tough negotiator, Local 371 became the mighty, mighty union, and membership grew from 9,000 to 17,000 members. He received numerous awards for his work, among them the prestigious Ellis Island Medal of Honor in 2001. And whereas Charles Ensley served on a number of boards, including the AFSCME International Executive Board, he enjoyed jazz, theater, and reading that ranged from Russian literature to French existentialism, with the particular interest in black history and the development of the black novel. In addition, he was a collector of black art and surrounded himself with some well-known and lesser-known artists from around the world. And whereas prior to his death, Charles Ensley asked that everyone, particularly Local 371 members, use time, energy, and resources in maintaining the mighty, mighty union. He was a true asset to society. And whereas Charles Ensley distinguished himself in his profession and by his sincere dedication and substantial contribution to the welfare of his community. And whereas Charles Ensley's commitment to excellence and his spirit of humanity carried over into all fields of enterprise, including charitable and civic endeavors. And whereas Charles Ensley is survived by his wife, Annette, his sister, Barbara Jean, his nephews, Bradley and Clarence, his niece, Amani, among many cousins. And whereas armed with the humanistic spirit, imbued with a sense of compassion, and comforted by a loving family, Charles Ensley's life was a portrait of service, a legacy which will endure the passage of time and will remain as a comforting memory to all he served and befriended. Now, therefore, be it resolved that this legislative body pause in its deliberations to mourn the death of Local 371 President Charles Stephen Ensley, distinguished citizen and devoted member of his community, and be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution, suitably engrossed, be transmitted to the family of Charles Ensley.
Senator Smith.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Colleagues, it is on very rare occasions you have the opportunity to celebrate someone's life. Normally, when a person passes, obviously there is remorse, there is concern, your heart is broken, your spirit seems shattered because of the separation of that person's involvement in your life. Charles Ensley was that person. And while my heart is very heavy, for someone who had a tremendous amount of integrity, a tremendous amount of independence, leadership, one who, regardless of how one felt about a decision that he made, if he gave you his word for something, it was clear. I can remember my first attempts at running for office when I was what you would call an insurgent, and every single person was on the other side of the fence from me. Charles Ensley was a person who stood up to not only to the powers that be of DC 37, but to all other labor supporters and said, I'm going to be with this person. Took a lot of heat for it, as Senator Savino can tell you, for years. But he was that kind of a person. But I rise today to say to Charles that I will never forget your friendship. I will never forget what you stood for the poor people of the city of New York. Most people think union leaders represents those who are working. Yes, that is true. But Charles represented people who were not working. He represented a lot of people who felt as though nobody would speak up for them. And he would at times put his own personal integrity and his leadership of his particularly local on the line. I can't tell you of a finer local leader than Charles Ensley. I've known many of them. Many of you know them. For those of you who had not had the opportunity to know Charles Ensley, you missed a real special person. This resolution that we're going to adopt today is well worded. But if I had to describe its total explanation of Charles Ensley, I'd say it represents only 10%. Because the emotion and the spirit of this individual, one could not capture in words. So I stand here today. I congratulate my colleague, Senator Diane Savino, for not only this resolution, but thank you for introducing me to Charles. It was because of you that I developed this very special relationship. And I ask all my colleagues that you will say a silent prayer for this individual at some point during your day, because this is a loss to the people of this state, no question about it. And Senator Diane Savino, my heart goes out to you as well, because I know how close you and Charles was. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Smith. Senator Parker on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President, on the resolution. We have not come to bury Charles Ensley today, but to celebrate his life. And this was a life certainly worth living. To paraphrase King, it is not where a person stands in times of comfort, but in times of challenge and in times of difficulty in which people are judged. And certainly you found Charles Ensley on the front lines every single time it mattered. Every single time it was important for somebody to stand up and do the right thing, you found Charles Ensley at the front and prepared to do the right thing despite what everybody else said or what anybody else did. Similar to Senator Smith's testimony today, I have a similar testimony in which when I ran for office and no one was ready to support me, Charles Ensley did the right thing and came forward for me. And I share my condolences to you, Diane, who I know you were very, very close to President Ensley. He was somebody who not only led the members of Local 371 of DC-37 with courage and dignity and a knife-cutting honesty, but somebody who saw himself as a leader of New Yorkers all over the state, particularly working men and women who were trying to just make a way in the world. And people who didn't have much. You know, not only, you know, the Social Service Workers Union is a group of people who work with the least of those in our society. And so he saw both the mission of helping his actual members who were doing the work as well as the clients that they served as his constituency. And I rededicate myself today to those same principles of making sure that every New Yorker, particularly the least of those in our societies, are in fact cared for and get the best possible representation they can. We remember and honor the life and the legacy of Charles Ensley.
Thank you, Senator Parker. Senator Liz Krueger.
I too want to rise to say that it is a real loss to us all for Charles Ensley no longer being on this earth with us. Like some of my other colleagues, I knew Charles a long time. I knew him long before I even thought about running for political office. I was running not-for-profit organizations, working on behalf of low-income New Yorkers, working side by side with members of 371, sometimes not always being in agreement with 371, and needing to go in and talk to Charles about why what he thought was the right answer for his workers might not have been the right answer for the low-income people of the city of New York who his workers work with day by day. Worked with him to argue against fundamentally wrong policies of the Giuliani administration during those years, worked with him to improve federal law, state law, government regulations and policies that affected both his workers and millions of people in the city of New York. And he never forgot why he had the job he did, that his job was to represent his members, but to represent the fundamental core values of society and government's obligations to help those most in need. And he was an amazing man. And so hopefully none of us will forget the lessons of Charles Ensley's life and what he actually did for all of us, whether we ever knew him or not. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Liz Krueger. Senator Duane.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also rise to speak in tribute of Charles Ensley. On so many levels, he was an amazing man. I want to say, because I don't want to forget this, not least of which was, I don't want to say discovering, but recognizing, investing in, mentoring, supporting one of the finest elected officials and union leaders I have ever met or worked with, Diane Savino. And so that, for that alone, he deserves enormous praise. Charles Ensley, within his union, was a voice of conscience and reason and determination, and he was a person who never forgot the mission of the members of his local and of his union. And that was a combination of making sure that his workers had the strongest possible voice for their well-being, as well as making sure that the mission of their workers was also to serve people. Because the members of that union are the people who are front lines in making life a little bit better and a little bit easier for people who need help, and in fact are, for those of us who believe that government can make a difference in people's lives, these are the actual municipal workers who make a difference in people's lives. To listen to Charles Ensley talk about case managers or social workers was wonderful. When I had the honor of serving on the city council, when he would come and testify, and he was riveting, and he was always on point, and he was convincing, and he was amazing. Some of you know this, many of you may know, some of you may know it, that you know, there were various things in the New York City Council that, you know, I was known for and here as well, but the thing that I am most proud of is the thing that I worked with Charles Ensley and frankly Diane Savino, and that was Local Law 49, which, when former Mayor Giuliani first tried to eliminate the city's Division of Aid Services, now called HASA, and then when he failed at doing that, tried to, under the guise of reform, decimate it, we were able to put that part of that agency, that department, into law, so no mayor, no one could ever, ever, ever eliminate it or destroy it. And Charles and Diane and people in the activist community. It was the most amazing thing, and it is the model for how it is that we should provide social services. And though it's now 13 years ago that that law was passed, it is a model for how social services should be provided, and I believe that, that Charles would agree with that. Loyal, forceful, smart, funny sometimes, just an amazing, just a giant lion in the labor movement for the people of the city of New York and for people for the people that he represented and for the people that he represented, the people that they helped every day. A tremendous loss, but I think, as I think about it now, every day that we do something that impacts people through our social services or children and families legislation here, I'm going to think of what would Charles do? How would Charles get this done? How would Charles, where would he find common ground? He'll be tremendously missed and not forgotten. And Diane, I am so sorry for your loss.
Senator Diane Savino.
Thank you, Mr. President. I am going to try and do this without getting too upset. The person that you heard Senator Parker and Senator Smith and Senator Duane and Senator Krueger talk about, and you heard Tommy read about, is everything that they said he was. But he's more than that. He is the person who is principally responsible for who I am today and why I'm standing here. He was not just the president of my union, although he was. He was my friend, my mentor, in many ways, a father to me in a way my own father wasn't. So that's the personal part of Charles, and that's why it's a tremendous loss to me. But for the people of the city of New York, the people of the state of New York, and more importantly, for the labor movement, it is a tremendous loss. You know, we read every day about union leaders. Matter of fact, I think the Post did a story this week about the exorbitant salaries of union leaders and how they're not representing their membership. You will never see anything remotely like that.
Can we please have some order in the chamber? Thank you.
You will never see anything remotely like that written about Charles Inslee. He was fiercely independent, fiercely proud, and actually had real disdain for those who would abuse the leadership of working people. He had a perverse sense that a union leader should never get too far away from the membership. And in fact, he had a hard and fast rule that the president of the union, particularly in a civil service union, he would not earn more than his civil service title. And in fact, all of us who worked at the union office were in the same position. And he would say, girl, if you want a raise, we'll negotiate it at the bargaining table. And if you want a promotion, you take a civil service test. He felt incredibly strongly about that union leaders should never get that far away from their members, that you had to live under the contract to really understand what your union members needed. In an age where union presidents are earning $300,000 a year, that would never have happened with Charles. He was the person to demand honesty and integrity in his parent union. He is the one who uncovered the scandals at Council 37, which led to the administratorship and the eventual jailing of several union leaders for abusing the union's membership. He never gave up trying to fight to improve Council 37, and his loss is a tremendous loss, not just for them, but for all of us. Because over the years, not just at the bargaining table, and not just in the halls of government, he recognized his responsibility to improve the lives of the people that he represented, as well as the people they served. As I said, he is principally responsible for who I am today. He taught me everything I ever knew about unions. He taught me everything I ever knew about government. And every day, like you, Tom, when I look at a problem, I find myself saying, what would Charles do? And the greatest loss to me right now is I can't call him and ask him. But I know what he would do. And I think we all do. Any of us who were touched by his life would know what Charles would do. And so, as Kevin said, I will commit every day that I'm in office or in public life to continue in the tradition of Charles Inslee, who left this world a better place than he found it, left the labor movement a far better place than he found it, and a voice who is so desperately needed for working people has been silenced. But it won't be as long as people like myself, Kevin, and Liz, and Tom, and Malcolm, who knew him and worked with him, will be able to continue his legacy. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Savino. I ask all members in the chamber to please rise to honor, in a moment of silence, the life of Charles Inslee. This resolution was unanimously adopted on June 25th. Senator Serrano.
President, at this time I move to recall Senate Rezo number 6260, which was previously adopted, and I ask that Senator Little be permitted to speak on the resolution.
I would ask for order in the chamber. Senator Little honors the passing of former New York State Assemblyman James Preston King. Senator Little.
I rise today and ask all of my colleagues to join me as we recognize a lifetime of achievement by James Preston King. He truly was one of the most honorable public servants that I have ever known. And in recognition of his public service, the Government Law Center at Albany Law School in April created the Lifetime Achievement in Public Services Award, awarded it to Jim King, and thereby named that award after him. Jim King was a man of many talents and wore many hats. He had many titles. He was a Marine Corps general of the JAG Corps. He was an assemblyman who left office in 1995, and I was elected to complete his term. He was a Court of Claims judge. He was chief counsel to the Secretary of State. He was a commissioner on the Lobbying Commission, a member of the Public Integrity Commission. He was a professor at Siena College and Albany Law School. He was a leader of the band and a trombonist. Many of us enjoyed his music at one time or another. But the titles that were most important to him were that of husband. He was husband to Jane, who predeceased him after 47 years of marriage, and to Anne, his wife of the past 3 years. He was dad to 3 sons, his son Jim and Ticonderoga, his son David, who is a member of the finance staff of the majority here, his son Glenn, who is works at the Attorney General's office. In all of these things, Jim King was helping other people and always out to do what he could for others. And his entire lifetime was spent doing that in the many roles that he played. But I think of all the titles that I like the best of Jim King is that I can use in talking about him personally as being a friend. So I thank you for recognizing him today and for honoring his family with a legislative resolution that we have passed and that I will forward to his family. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Little. Senator Farley, on the resolution.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I also rise to support what Senator Little had to say about one of the most remarkable men that I ever met, an incredible person that grew up in modest circumstances, went into the Marine Corps, ended up as a general, the adjutant general, a distinguished lawyer, law professor, assemblyman, trombone player. He had everything in the world. I never saw anybody that was so diversified in his talents. And not only on top of that, as he served in the assembly, I don't know anybody that didn't love him. He was the nicest man to work with from both sides of the aisles. Jim King was respected and loved. He was a wonderful father with a absolutely gorgeous wife and beautiful children, and everything he did, He did well. He served as an assemblyman in my district, and it was an absolute joy to work with him. And Jim King, every time you met him or had a dealing with him, you came away feeling good. Jim King is a remarkable man and somebody that really made quite an impact in this world. And I wish he and his family all the best, because they can be very proud of the legacy that their father left. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Farley. Senator Leibel.
Mr. President, I just want to echo my colleague's comments. Having served in the Assembly, I served there with Jim King, and he truly was a remarkable man with a wonderful family. I recall when my children were young, he and his wife Jane inviting our family to spend a weekend with him up in the district, Betty, and it was a wonderful weekend. He was great with kids, but also, as has been noted, a remarkable career of public service to New York State, but also before that to this country. He was a fairly senior officer in the Marine Corps when he was serving in Vietnam, and we often talked about his experiences there. He was a great public servant, a great American, and who we sorely missed.
Thank you, Senator Leibel. I ask all persons in the chamber to please rise and join me a moment of silence in the passing of James Preston King. Senator Serrano.
At this time, I move to adopt the resolution calendar in its entirety.
All those in favor of adopting the resolution calendar in its entirety, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The resolution calendar is adopted. Senator Serrano.
Mr. President, at this time, can we go to a reading of the calendar?
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 239 by Senator Valesky, Senate Print 6718A, an act relating to authorizing.
A home rule message is at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 600 by Senator Stuart Cousins, Senate Print 6697, an act to amend the general municipal law.
A home rule message is here at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 807 by Member of the Assembly Perry. Assembly Print number 3563, an act to amend the election law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 30th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 807 are Senators Golden, Griffo, Nozzolio, Skelos, and Volker. Ayes 56. Also Senator Young. Ayes 55. Nays 6.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 929 by Senator Stuart Cousins. Senate print.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 974 by Senator DeLon. Senate Print 3772A, an act to amend the public authorities law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 974 are Senators DeFrancisco, Flanagan, O'Johnson, Laval, Libel, Little, Marcelino, Ranzenhofer, Saland, Skelos, Volker, and Winner. Also Senator Larkin. Also Senator Fuscillo. Also Senator Bonasek. Ayes 46, nays 15.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1021 by Senator Foley, Senate Print 7263C, an act to amend the public service.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 1196 by Senator Stewart.
Bill is laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 1197 by Member of the Assembly Pfeffer, Assembly Print number 275A, an act to establish a New York State Automatic Identification Technology Privacy Task Force.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1197 are Senators DeFrancisco, Farley, Flanagan, Golden, Hannon, O'Johnson, Lanza, Larkin, Laval, Libous, Little, Marcelino, Maziarz, Ranzenhofer, Seward, Skelos, and Winner. Also Senator Saland. Ayes 43, nays 18.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1276 by Senator Adams. Concurrent resolution of the Senate and Assembly proposing an amendment.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 286, Senate Budget Bill, Senate Print 6601A.
Bill is laid aside for the day. Senator Serrano, that completes the non-controversial calendar.
Mr. President, can I remove the lay aside for the day on calendar 1196?
Senator Serrano, we will remove the lay aside for the day for 1196 and call that back up onto the non-controversial calendar.
Calendar number 1196 by Senator Stewart Cousins, Senate Print 7190, an act to provide an apportionment.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator Robach to explain his vote.
Very briefly, Mr. President, to explain my vote, obviously everyone is always doing what they can to try and benefit their constituents, students, and education, but this clearly should be a budget item, and while in all due respect to the sponsor, I understand the need in her community, certainly there are needier communities, others that would like to have the same thing, and I think these are items that should be included in the budget, not done in separate preferential treatment for one group of constituents rather than another. And so for that reason, I am forced to vote in the negative.
Senator Robach to be recorded in the negative. Senator Stewart Cousins to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I certainly rise to thank my colleagues who will support this measure for the children of Yonkers. For however many decades, Yonkers has once
and several times implored the state to create a formula that works for Yonkers. Yonkers is in a unique position, neither fish nor fowl. While it is in Westchester County, the population in the school district qualify for free and reduced lunch. Even Senator Skelos in 2008, in our daily newspaper headlines, Skelos backs more state education money for Yonkers and said that he would back rewriting the state education funding formula for the city. There was not an easy way to do it because anything you do triggers things for other communities. So the superintendent, in conjunction with other leaders in our district, realized that one way to do it was to look at the increased enrollment. And over the past year, the enrollment has increased by almost 600 young people, and that's not included in the formula. So whereas the funding had been cut in the city of Yonkers, there had been no consideration for the increase. This allows for consideration going forward for the increase in the student body and the realization that Yonkers indeed is one of the big five, is unique, and certainly in this respect should have all of its students counted. So certainly I vote aye.
Senator Stewart Cousins to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Farley to explain his vote.
Thank you. Nobody likes to vote against anything for Yonkers, but let me just say that when we don't even fund libraries for $2 million, we could take some of this money and statewide help the education system by for everyone with supporting libraries. I vote no.
Senator Farley, you recorded in the negative. Secretary, announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1196 are Senators Alisi, Bonasek, DeFrancisco, Farley, Flanagan, Fuscillo, Golden, Griffo, Hannon, O. Johnson, Lanza, Larkin, Laval, Libel, Libous, Little, Marcelino, Maziarz, McDonald, Nizzolio, Padovan, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Saland, Seward, Skelos, Volker, Winner, and Young. Ayes 32, nays 29.
Senator Saland to explain his vote. I apologize, Senator Saland.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, I merely wanted to make comment on the fact that Yonkers already receives an enhancement grant that none of the other big four receive. Somewhere to the area, I believe, might be somewhere there as much as $17 million. So there certainly has been a recognition in the monies that have been driven under the existing education formula to the particular needs of the city of Yonkers. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Saland. You were recorded in the negative.
In the negative.
Announce the results, 32-29. The bill is passed. Senator Serrano, now that completes the non-controversial calendar.
Thank you, Mr. President. At this time, can we go to a controversial reading of the calendar?
Secretary will ring the bell. Members are all asked to come to the chamber for a reading of the controversial calendar. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 929 by Senator Stuart Cousins, Senate Print 7962C, an act to amend the general municipal law.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard on the bill? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will please ring the bells.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 929 are Senators Alisi, Bonasek, DeFrancisco, Farley, Flanagan, Fuscillo, Golden, Griffo, Hannon, O. Johnson, Lanza, Larkin, Laval, Libel, Libous, Little, Marcelino, Maziarz, McDonald, Nozzolio, Padovan, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Saland, Seward, Skelos, Volker, Winner, and Young. Ayes 32, nays 29.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1021 by Senator Foley. Senate Prince.
President, can we lay that bill aside temporarily?
Bill is laid aside temporarily. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1276 by Senator Adams. Senate Print 8119A, concurrent resolution of the Senate and Assembly proposing an amendment to Section 9 of Article 1 of the Constitution.
Are there any senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Senator Padovan. Okay.
To that, please.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator Padovan to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. It's an old adage, when you know it's the session's going to end, when there's a gambling bill that's before us. And here we are again, as we have been for decades now, with some additional type of gambling venue imposed upon the people of this state. And I'm just simply going to explain my vote, because if we went on to the, we could go on by the hour in terms of talking about this issue. Here's where we are. We are the state in this great nation with the greatest number of problem and compulsive gamblers, over 1 million people. We are a state that gambles somewhere in excess of over $50 billion annually in all of the various venues that are out there. We are the gambling state and no longer the Empire State. Why has that happened? Year after year, a new gambling idea began with the lottery in the 60s, an annual event, semi-annual, and now every minute, depending on how fast you can scratch off a card. Super Lotto, Quick Draw, VLTs at racetracks, Indian casinos. On a per capita basis, we gamble more in New York State than any state, including Nevada. And that's money that's sucked right out of the economy. And if you don't think there's a price to pay for it, there is. In social services, in criminality, in disruption in local communities, wherever these venues are. There are all kinds of studies all over the country, including in New York, by the New York State Council on Problem Gambling, that tell us the more opportunities you have, the more problems you create. And this amendment, if it ever became a reality, constitutional amendment, would just be one more opportunity, building upon all the others that have brought us to the state we're in, and I will be voting no.
Senator Padovan to be recorded in the negative. Are there any other senators wishing to explain their vote? Seeing none, announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number. Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1276 are Senators Diaz, Duane, Hannon, L. Krueger, Laval, Leibel, Marcelino, Padovan, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Saland, Skelos, and Volker. Also Senator Elisi. Ayes 47, nays 14.
The amendment passes.
Calendar number 1286, Senate Budget Bill. Senate Print 6601A, an act making appropriations.
Can we lay that bill aside for the day?
Bill is laid aside for the day.
Yeah, I did lay it aside.
Senator Serrano.
Madam President, there will be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332. Pending the return of the Rules Committee, can we please stand at ease?
There'll be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332. Pending the return of the Rules Committee, the Senate stands at ease. Senator Klein.
Madam President, I believe there's a rules report at the desk. I move that we adopt the report at this time.
Senator Klein, there is a report of the Rules Committee at the desk. The Secretary will read.
Senator Smith from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Senate Print 754 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend the general business law. 1385 by Senator Duane, an act to amend the elder law. 2208B by Senator Diaz, an act to amend the elder law. 2361C by Senator Parker, an act to amend the general business law. 2809 by Senator Moran, an act to amend the tax law. 3182A by Senator Marcelino, an act to authorize. 3317A by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the administrative code of the City of New York. 3430 by Senator Breslin, an act to amend Chapter 415 of the laws of 1913. 4786A by Senator L. Krueger, an act to amend the insurance law. 5108 by Senator Savino, an act to amend the workers' compensation law. 5388A by Senator Squadron, an act to amend the public authorities law. 5439B by Senator Valesky, an act to amend the racing, paramutual wagering, and breeding law. 5768 by Senator Schneiderman, an act to amend the business corporation law. 5794A by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the agriculture and markets law. 6418A by Senator C. Johnson, an act to amend the penal law. 6432 by Senator Skelos, an act to amend Chapter 846 of the laws of 1970. 6726 by Senator Stokowski, an act to amend the limited liability company law. 6832A by Senator O. Johnson, an act to amend Chapter 572 of the laws of 1994. 6932 by Senator Montgomery, an act to amend the social services law. 6977 by Senator Larkin, an act to amend the criminal procedure law. 6990B by Senator Aubertine, an act to create. 7282 by Senator Laval, an act designating. 7410B by Senator Espada, an act to amend the general business law. 7462A by Senator Perkins, an act to amend Chapter 174 of the laws of 1968. 8255 by Senator C. Krueger, an act to amend the tax law. 8349 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the general municipal law. 8372 by Senator Klein, an act to amend the education law. 8380 by Senator Savino, an act to amend the labor law. 8390 by Senator Hassel Thompson, an act to amend the domestic relations law. And Senate Print 8357 by Senator Smith, an act to amend the transportation law. All bills ordered direct to third reading.
All those in favor of adopting the Rules Committee report, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Rules Committee report is adopted. Senator Klein.
Thank you, Madam President. At this time, can we please go to a reading of the supplemental calendar?
Secretary will proceed with a reading of the supplemental calendar.
In relation to calendar number 1294, Senator Duane moves to discharge from the Committee on Aging Assembly Bill number 3956 and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 1385, third reading calendar 1294.
Substitution ordered. Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 1295 by Senator Diaz. Senate Print 2208B, an act to amend the elder law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results. Senator DeFrancisco to explain his vote.
I'm voting no, not because I don't have the greatest respect of senior citizens, since I am one, but the fact that this is a task force, another task force. We seem to have a run on task force, bills in the last couple of weeks. We're in a budget situation that is very dire, and there seems to be more need for financial restraint. And that's why I'm voting no. Thank you.
Senator DeFrancisco to be recorded in the negative. Senator Saland to explain.
Thank you,
vote.
Madam President. Madam President, this bill is strangely similar, in fact, identical to a bill which I had passed, I believe, in 2008. And at that time, the governor vetoed it because of the fiscal. And however dire our situation was then, it's even more dire now. I believe the fiscal impact is somewhere in the area of $400,000. It's not provided for in the budget,
and it's with great reluctance that I find myself constrained to vote against a bill that I had previously introduced and carried, basically on the simple fact and premise that it's not provided for in the fiscal plan. It's definitely going to be vetoed, I would hope there would be a time and a place in which we can accomplish this, but this certainly is not going to be the time or the place. Thank you, Madam President.
Senator Salan to be reported in the negative. Are there any other senators wishing to explain their vote? Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1295 are Senators DeFrancisco, Flanagan, O. Johnson, Little, Ranzenhofer, Saland, Skelos, Winner, and Young. Ayes 52, nays 9.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1296, Senator Parker moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 1558C and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 2361C, third reading calendar 1296.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1296 by member of the Assembly, Gennaris, Assembly Print number 1558C, an act to amend the general business law.
Read the last section.
Section 6, this act shall take effect on the 150th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1296 are Senators DeFrancisco, Farley, Flanagan, Fuscillo, Golden, O. Johnson, Maziarz, Ranzenhofer, Saland, Skelos, and Young. Ayes 50, nays 11.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1297 by Senator Moorhan, Senate Print 2809, an act to amend the tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 60th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1298, Senator Marcelino moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 6742A and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 3182A, third reading calendar 1298.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1298 by member of the Assembly, Conti, Assembly Print number 6742A, an act to authorize payment.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Aye, 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1299, Senator Oppenheimer moves to discharge from the Committee on Housing, Construction, and Community Development Assembly Bill number 2365A and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 3317A, third reading calendar 1299.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1299 by member of the Assembly, O'Donnell, Assembly Print number 20.
Bill is laid aside.
In relation to calendar number 1300, Senator Breslin moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 6420 and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 3430, third reading calendar 1300.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1300 by member of the Assembly, Wiesenberg, Assembly Print number 6420, an act to amend Chapter 415 of the laws of 1913.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Aye, 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1301, Senator L. Krueger moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 5653A and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 4786A, third reading calendar 1301.
Substitution order.
Calendar number 1301 by member of the Assembly Rosenthal, Assembly print number 5653A, an act to amend the insurance law.
Read the last section. Bill is laid aside.
In relation to calendar number 1302, Senator Savino moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 619 and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 5108, third reading calendar 1302.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1302 by member of the Assembly Kavanaugh, Assembly print number 619, an act to amend the workers' compensation law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 30th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the result.
Aye, 60, nays, 1. Senator. In relation to calendar number 1302, ayes 59, nays 2. Senators DeFrancisco and Ranzenhofer recorded in the negative.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1303 by Senator Squadron, Senate print 5388A, an act to amend the public authorities law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results. Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1303 are Senators DeFrancisco, Farley, O. Johnson, Little, Marcelino, Ranzenhofer, Skellos, Volker, Winner, and Young. Ayes 51, nays 10.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1304 by Senator Valesky, Senate print 5439B, an act to amend the racing, paramutual wagering, and breeding law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1306, Senator Oppenheimer moves to discharge from the Committee on Agriculture Assembly Bill number 600B and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 5794A, third reading calendar 1306.
Substitution order.
Calendar number 1306 by member of the Assembly Cahill, Assembly print number 600B, an act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law.
Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect on the 60th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Aye, 61.
Bill is passed.
Excuse me. In relation to calendar number 1306, aye, 60, nays, 1. Senator Aubertin recorded in the negative.
Bill is still passed.
Calendar number 1307 by Senator C. Johnson, Senate print 6418A, an act to amend the penal law.
Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect September 1, 2010.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Senator Johnson to explain his vote.
Thank you very much, Madam President. We have a crisis throughout the state, but in particular, and I know my colleagues from Long Island know all too well, we have a real crisis of children dying as a result of overdoses and drugs, in particular heroin. The bill that you have before you today, bipartisan bill, co-sponsored by my friends Chuck Fischillo and Senator Jeffrey Klein, Brian Foley, Eric Adams, Daryl Albertin, Tom Moorhan, George Honorato, and Mike Ranzenhofer, will start the process of punishing those who kill our children with drugs. I notice that there is some opposition. I would urge my colleagues who oppose this bill to reverse that decision and support us. It is time to treat those who kill our children with drugs as the murderers that they are. We have to stop the madness. We have to stop the murder of our children when it comes to heroin and other drugs. I vote yes, Madam President. Thank you.
Senator C. Johnson to be recorded in the affirmative. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard or to explain their vote? Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1307 are Senators Duane, Hassel Thompson, and Montgomery. Ayes 58, nays 3.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1308, Senator Skelos moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 9750 and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 6432, third reading calendar 1308.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1308 by member of the Assembly Wiesenberg, Assembly Print number 9750, an act to amend chapter 846 of the laws of 1970.
There's a home rule message at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1309 by Senator Stokowski, Senate Print 6726, an act to amend the limited liability company law.
Read the last section.
Section 7. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator Bonasek to explain his vote.
I'll be brief. I should have asked Senator Stokowski the question. I think what is confusion is legislation in the definition of what is small profit as opposed to a profit company and a not-for-profit company. And there is no definition that I can see in the legislation that defines low profit. And that's going to create confusion and problems with the different kinds of companies. For that reason, I'm going to vote no and hope that the sponsor eventually clears this up.
Senator Bonasek to be recorded in the negative. Are there any other senators wishing to explain their vote? Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 1309 are senators.
Senator DeFrancisco to explain his vote. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I thought you were signaling me. Sorry, Tommy, go ahead.
Bonasek, DeFrancisco, Flanagan, Golden, Libel, Little, Nozzolio, Soland, Skelos, Winner, and Young. Ayes 50, nays 11.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1310, Senator O. Johnson moves to discharge from the Committee on Health Assembly Bill number 9999A and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 6832A, third reading calendar 1310.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1310 by member of the Assembly Sweeney, Assembly Print number 9999A, an act to amend chapter 572 of the laws of 1994.
Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Aye, 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1311, Senator Montgomery moves to discharge from the Committee on Health Assembly Bill number 5681A and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 6932, third reading calendar 1311.
Substitution ordered. Bill is laid aside.
In relation to calendar number 1312, Senator Larkin moves to discharge from the Committee on Codes Assembly Bill number 10005 and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 6977, third reading calendar 1312.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1312 by member of the Assembly Calhoun, Assembly Print number 10005, an act to amend the criminal procedure law.
Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 60, nays 1. Senator Duane recorded in the negative.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1313, Senator Aubertine moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 10027B and substituted for the identical Senate print number 6990B, third reading calendar 1313.
Substitution ordered.
Calendar number 1313 by member of the Assembly Brodsky, Assembly print number 10027B, an act to create a temporary New York State War of 1812 200th Anniversary Commemoration Commission.
Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Senator Maziarz to explain his vote.
Madam President, to very briefly explain my vote, I think this is a very good bill. We did pass this bill one other time, and the governor vetoed it. I hope he doesn't do that again, because this is a very important moment in New York State history and the history of our great country. And one of the most important battles took place at Fort Niagara in Niagara County, and we need this bill. Thank you. I vote in the affirmative.
Senator Maziarz to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Farley to explain his vote.
Yes, in support of this bill, I think Senator Albertine knows that Sackett's Harbor, a very famous War of 1812 battle where many, many Americans lost their lives, and a very significant battle. It's almost as significant, if not more so, than that battle in Niagara. But
definitely
anyway,
not more so. But.
I vote aye.
Senator Farley to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Volker to explain.
Yeah, very quickly, President. This is a very good bill. They burned Buffalo in 1811 and then 1812 during the War of 1812. And there was a lot of history, really, all through the area around the Great Lakes. But, of course, as Senator Albertine is going to show in this commission, there was a lot of activity in the North Country also. But it is a very good bill, and we are in Western New York planning on a lot of celebration at the time. The biggest thing is we're going to try to make sure Buffalo doesn't burn again. I vote aye.
Senator Volker to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Aye 61, nays 0.
Bill is passed.
In relation to calendar number 1314, Senator Laval moves to discharge from the Committee on Rules Assembly Bill number 10,466 and substituted for the identical Senate Bill number 7282, third reading calendar 1314.
Substitution order.
Calendar number 1314 by member of the Assembly Thiel, Assembly Print number 10,466, an act designating state-owned lands.
Senator Laval to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. This legislation would set aside a small piece in the hamlet of West Hampton, in the town of Southampton, in the name of Edwin Buzz Schwenk. Buzz Schwenk was born and lived in the town of Southampton until his death about a year ago. He was a businessman. He headed the Business Alliance and then headed the Long Island Housing Partnership. He was very much involved in development, and then one day there was an epiphany where Buzz Schwenk came and said, you know, I was born, I've lived in Southampton, and we've got to preserve the Pine Barrens in Southampton. He joined with Assemblyman Tom DiNapoli at the time to be part of a working group that developed the Pine Barrens Preservation Act, preserving 100,000 acres. And to his death, he wanted to make sure that the town of Southampton had open space that was preserved. So he went from a non-environmentalist to an environmentalist and a preservationist of the land. I vote in the affirmative, Mr. Madam President.
Senator Laval will be recorded in the affirmative. Secretary will call the roll. Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately. Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young. Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
In relation to, calendar number 1315 by Senator Espada, Senate Print 7410B, an act to amend the general business law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1316 by Senator Perkins, Senate Print 7462A, an act to amend chapter 174 of the laws of 1968.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1317 by Senator C. Krueger, Senate Print 8255, an act to amend the tax law and the administrative code of the City of New York.
Read the last section.
Section 4 of this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the result.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1318 by Senator Parker. Senate print.
Bill is laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 1319 by Senator Klein. Senate print. 8372, an act to amend the education law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 60, nays 1. Senator Duane recorded in the negative.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1320 by Senator Savino. Senate print 8380, an act to amend the labor law.
Bill is high and be laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 1321 by Senator Hassel-Thompson. Senate print 8390, an act to amend the domestic relations law.
The bill is high. It will be laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 1322 by Senator Smith. Senate print 8357, an act to amend the transportation law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61.
Bill is passed. Senator Klein, that completes the reading of the non-controversial supplemental calendar.
Madam President, at this time, can we please go to a reading of the controversial supplemental calendar?
Secretary will read. Secretary will ring the bells for the, and announce the reading of the controversial supplemental calendar. Senator Seward.
I was unavoidably out of the chamber when 1296 passed a few moments ago, and I would ask unanimous consent to be recorded in the negative on calendar number 1296.
Senator Seward, with unanimous consent, you will be recorded in the negative on calendar 1296. Yes. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1294, substituted earlier today by Member of the Assembly Kellner, Assembly Print Number 3956, an act to amend the elder law.
Are there any senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Aside temporarily.
Bill is laid aside temporarily. Roll call is withdrawn. Bill is laid aside temporarily.
Calendar number 1299.
Senator Breslin.
I request to be recorded, have unanimous consent to be recorded negative on calendar number 1315.
Senator Breslin, by unanimous consent, you will be recorded in the negative on calendar 1315. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1299, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly O'Donnell. Assembly print number 2365A, an act to amend the administrative code of the City of New York.
Read the last section. Oh, I'm ahead of myself here. Senator Hannon.
1299.
We are on calendar number 1299.
Would the sponsor yield to a question, sure. Madam President?
Senator Oppenheimer, would you yield to a question?
Okay, what is this? Know that one. Yes.
Senator Oppenheimer yields.
Senator Oppenheimer, I noticed that you give a right to a victim of domestic violence, and you define how one would be a victim of domestic violence by referencing the social services law. And you say that a person may retain certain residency status by, quote, asserting an intent to return to the housing accommodation. Could you tell me what time period, and you say that you make that exact same statement in three or four places in your bill, so affecting different provisions of the rent control and rent stabilization laws. Would you be able to tell me when a person has to assert an intent, and I'm using the word assert an intent right from your proposal?
I can tell you the intent of the law. It is for those domestic violence victims that have to flee the residence, their primary residence, because they are being threatened. And so they are, with this bill, they would be permitted to leave their primary residence with the intention of coming back to that primary residence when the situation is resolved. As it is domestic violence, you can't say it will be resolved in 2 months or 4 months, but the intent is that the rent will still be paid and they will be coming back to that residence.
Would the senator yield for another question?
Senator Oppenheimer, will you continue to yield?
Of course.
Senator Oppenheimer yields.
So would it be an assumption on my part that you intend to put into this bill that only so long as the particular factual circumstances attendant to that domestic violence are continuing, then when that is ceasing, then one may assert the intent at that point?
Through you, Madam Chair. I would think that there's no need to spell that out. Anyone who's experienced domestic violence knows you can't determine how long it's going to take. But the tenant will continue to pay rent and plans to come back. So, I mean, that's the best I can tell you. And I don't think we can put any specificity into it because of the nature of the violation.
Would the senator continue to yield?
Senator Oppenheimer, will you continue
yes,
to yield?
Yes, I will.
Let me give you a hypothetical that's kind of the other side of what I've just asked. Suppose somebody is a victim of domestic violence. And by the way, I appreciate the intent of the bill. I think it's laudatory. But suppose somebody is a victim of domestic violence. They, for reasons not necessarily related to that unfortunate circumstance, happen to either sublet, legally or illegally, happen to just not be there, and 2 or 3 years later decide that they want to go back to that residence. Can they then make some type of intent to return?
To you, Madam President, it's written here in the law that the victim asserts the intent to return to the housing accommodation, and the victim, this domestic violence victim, will be deemed to be occupying the unit as his primary residence, as her primary residence during that period of time. I think the opportunity to sublet if she is occupying the residence would not be possible.
Madam President, would the senator continue to yield?
Senator Oppenheimer, will you continue to yield?
Yes, I do.
So may I infer that, I'm looking at the timeliness of the assertion, not the condition and all those things. So may I infer that there must be a reasonable timeliness of the conveyance that they want to return?
You know, I wish I could be more specific for you, but domestic violence is not specific. And it says the victim is deemed to be living in that residence during that time that she is not living in the residence, but she is paying rent. And that's the best I can tell you, and I think that's the best that can be said under these circumstances.
Would the senator continue to yield?
Senator Oppenheimer, do you continue to yield?
So you're saying that so long as somebody's a victim of domestic violence, that at any time thereafter, whether or not that domestic violence has ceased, and they can assert an intent to return? Is that what you're saying?
The victim who has left the unit because of this violence and who asserts an intent to return to the housing accommodation, as I said earlier, is deemed as though they were occupying, she was occupying, I shouldn't say she, it could be a man too, occupying the unit as his primary residence. So I think it's pretty much spelled out.
Madam President, would the senator continue to yield?
Senator
sure.
Oppenheimer?
Yes,
continues
I do.
To yield.
Very simply, Senator Oppenheimer, when do you have to assert that intent?
That is not written in the law as to when the victim decides that the domestic violence has reached a point that she is threatened. That is not written into the law, and I don't see how it can be.
On the bill, Madam President.
Senator Hannan on the bill.
Given the intent, I think there needs to be some type of reasonableness built into the statute, absent the fact that there is any type of provision for reasonable notification. It does not have to be specific. It doesn't have to be a given time period. I'm unable to support this. I think it's poorly written, and I don't think it would be upheld in the courts. Thank you.
Senator Hannan to be recorded in the negative. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard on the bill? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 61, nays 0.
Bill is passed.
Excuse me, in relation to calendar number 1299, ayes 60, nays 1, ayes 59, nays 2. Senators Golden and Hannon recorded in the negative.
Bill is still passed. Yes, Secretary will
calendar read. Number 1301, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly Rosenthal. Assembly print number 5653A, an act to amend the insurance law.
Any senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, debate is closed. Oh, Senator, I'm sorry, Senator Haddad.
On the bill, Madam President?
On the bill.
This bill, which has a common sense logic that you shouldn't pay more than your copay, unfortunately is unworkable because there's no place to define the usual and customary cost of such a prescribed drug. It says that if the copayment exceeds the usual and customary cost prescribed drug, they can't charge you that usual and customary cost. It's not defined. There are other mechanisms in this proposal that talk about the posted retail price and when the copayment exceeds the pharmacy's usual and customary price. We have three separate standards in a bill that exceeds about 31 lines. If you really want to protect the individual customer of the pharmacy, I think you need a far better set of definitions. You need definitions that use state law. You need things like average wholesale price. These are customary standards. These are defined standards, but the ones that are in this bill are not defined. I would think that it's just unworkable and needs to be redone. Thank you, Madam President.
Senator Hannon to be recorded in the negative. Are there any other senators wishing to speak on the bill? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Read the last section.
Section 4, this act will take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Announce the results.
Ayes 59, nays 2. Relation to calendar number 1301, those recorded in the negative are Senators Golden, Hannon, and O. Johnson. Ayes 58, nays 3.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 1311, substituted earlier today by member...
Bill is laid aside for the day. Senator Klein, that completes the reading of the controversial supplemental calendar.
Madam President?
Yes.
Can we go back to calendar number 1294, print number 1385, Senator Duane's bill? Can we remove the lay aside?
The lay aside is removed from calendar number 1294. Secretary will read on calendar number 1294 on the controversial calendar.
Calendar number 1294, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly, Kellner. Assembly print number 3956, an act to amend the elder law.
Are there any senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Krueger, Skello, Smith, Young.
Diaz is voting now. What is that? Bill is laid aside temporarily. Senator Klein, that completes the reading of the controversial supplemental calendar.
Madam President, could we briefly return to motions and resolutions?
Returning to motions and resolutions.
On behalf of Senator Arbatine, I wish to call up print number 7936, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1056 by Senator Arbatine, Senate print 7936, an act to amend Chapter 106 of the laws of 2003.
Madam President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill was passed.
Secretary will call the roll on reconsideration.
Madam Zespada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young, aye, 61.
Senator Klein.
Madam President, I now offer the following amendments.
Amendments are received.
Madam President, on behalf of Senator Thompson, I wish to call up print number 7488A, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 1234 by Senator Thompson, Senate print 7488A, an act to amend the public authorities law.
Senator Klein.
Madam President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill was passed.
Secretary will call the roll on reconsideration.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young, aye, 61.
Senator
Madam
Klein.
President, I now offer the following amendments.
Amendments are received.
Madam President, at this time, can we call up calendar number 1201, Senate print number 7263C on the controversial calendar?
Secretary will read. Senator Klein, do you mean calendar number 1021?
Senate number 7263C.
Secretary will read calendar number 1021 on the controversial calendar.
Calendar number 1021 by Senator Foley, Senate print 7263C, an act to amend the public service law.
Senator Foley, an explanation has been requested. Billow.
Thank you, Madam President. Now, this legislation will strengthen consumer protection in the event of a merger between two telephone companies. Specifically, the bill requires the PSC to address a set of public interest standards during its review of a sale or merger. Further, this legislation only affects mergers when one of the two parties' gross annual New York revenues exceeds $200 million. And further, this legislation would only cover residential mergers. There are 11 specific public interest standards that the acquiring corporation must meet and that the PSC must find. And I'll be happy to go into those standards later in the debate. Let me just give a little geographic history to this, if I may, Madam President. In the spring of 2008, Fairpoint Communications purchased the telephone networks in Vermont, New Hampshire, and Maine. They were saddled with a $1 billion debt in the transaction and were wholly unprepared to operate the 1.7 million additional landlines. In fact, it was widely acknowledged that since this conversion occurred with Fairpoint, Fairpoint had been plagued their customers, rather, with many complaints and quality concerns. What this bill is about, Madam President, is essentially two things. One, it is designed to balance the interest of ratepayers and the investors to do it in a fair way. And finally, this bill, and most importantly, why I've sponsored this bill and have over 21 co-sponsors, this bill will strengthen the PSC's already existing authority by creating standards to protect consumers, to protect workers, and to protect the local economy before it approves a sale or merger. Most importantly, Madam Chair, and most succinctly, it will ensure that New York is not victimized by a bad sale. Thank you, Madam President.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, the debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bells. Senator Johnson.
Madam President, I request a slow roll call for this vote, please.
Seeing as five senators have stood up, a slow roll call is in order. We have to read the last section. Secretary will read the last section and then call the roll slowly.
Section 4. This act shall take effect on the 120th day. Senator Adams.
Yes.
Senator Addabbo.
Yes.
Senator Alisi.
No.
Senator Aubertine.
Aye.
Senator Bonasek. Senator Breslin. Senator DeFrancisco. Senator Diaz. Senator DeLon. Senator Duane. Senator Espada. Senator Farley. Senator Flanagan. Senator Foley.
Madam President.
Senator Foley to explain his vote.
Thank you. I outlined earlier the summary of the bill, but I also think it's instructive, Madam President, that this bill is virtually identical with, in fact, in two ways, a little bit more restrictive, but virtually identical to two bills that were sponsored 2 years ago. And at that time, the lead sponsor of the bill was Senator Nozzolio, Senator Fuscillo, Senator Hannan, Larkin, Laval, and Moorhan, were the co-sponsors of that particular bill, which is virtually identical to this bill. And prior to that, in 07, we had not only Senator Spano, but Senator Bonasek, Senator DeFrancisco, Senator Larkin, Senator Leibel, Senator Moorhan, Senator Padovan, in fact, my predecessor, Senator Trunzo, all had supported a bill that is virtually identical to the bill that we're voting on here this afternoon. I vote aye.
Senator Foley to be recorded in the affirmative. Secretary will continue to call the roll slowly.
Senator Fuscillo. Senator Golden. Senator Griffo. Senator Hannan. Senator Hassel-Thompson. Senator Huntley. Senator C. Johnson. Senator O. Johnson. Senator Klein.
Yes.
Senator L. Krueger.
Yes.
Senator C. Krueger.
Yes.
Senator Lanza.
No.
Senator Larkin.
No.
Senator Laval.
No.
Senator Leibel.
No.
Senator Libous.
No.
Senator Little.
She said.
Senator Marcelino.
No.
Senator Maziarz.
No.
Senator McDonald.
No.
Senator Montgomery.
No.
Senator Moorhan excused. Senator Nozzolio. Senator Honorado.
Yes.
Senator Oppenheimer.
Yes.
Senator Padovan.
No.
Senator Parker.
Yes.
Senator Peralta.
Yes.
Senator Perkins.
Yes.
Senator Ranzenhofer.
No.
Senator Robach. Senator Saland.
No.
Senator Sampson.
Aye.
Senator Savino.
Yes.
Senator Schneiderman.
Yes.
Senator Serrano.
Yes.
Senator Seward.
No.
Senator Skelos. Senator Smith.
Yes.
Senator Squadron. Senator Stokowski.
The roll call is withdrawn and the bill is laid aside for the day. Senator Klein, that completes the reading of the controversial calendar. Senator Klein.
Madam President, can we please stand at ease and come back to the chambers in about an hour? So that would be 10 to 6.
The Senate will stand at ease. Senator Libous.
Thank you. There'll be an immediate Republican conference room.
There'll be an immediate meeting of the Republican conference in the Republican conference room. The Senate will stand at ease until 10 minutes to 6 o'clock.
Majority Conference Room, pending the return of the Rules Committee, may we please stand at ease.
There's an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in the Majority Conference Room. Until then, the Senate stand at ease, Senator Libous.
Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I believe there's a rules report at the desk. I move that we adopt the report at this time.
There is a rules report at the desk. Secretary will read.
Senator Smith from the Committee on Rules reports the following bills. Senate Print 3180C by Senator Duane, an act to amend the public health law. 4117B by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the education law. 4181 by Senator Flanagan, an act to amend the highway law. 4431B by Senator Lanza, an act to amend the executive law. 5512A by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the education law. 5514 by Senator Stokowski, an act to amend the state finance law. 5614B by Senator Valesky, an act to amend the alcoholic beverage control law. 5628A by Senator Savino, an act to amend the retirement and social security law. 5969 by Senator Valesky, an act to amend the education law. 6646 by Senator Bonasek, an act to amend the executive law. 6861 by Senator LaValle, an act authorizing. 6888C by Senator Hassel Thompson, an act to amend the retirement and social security law. 7202A by Senator Skelos, an act authorizing. 7228A by Senator Stokowski, an act to amend the New York State Urban Development Corporation Act. 7255A by Senator Moynihan, an act to amend the mental hygiene law. 7267C by Senator Schneiderman, an act to amend the general business law. 7412B by Senator Montgomery, an act to amend the administrative code of the City of New York. 7480A by Senator Valesky, an act to amend the alcoholic beverage control law. 7517 by Senator Duane, an act to amend the social services law. 7580 by Senator Stachowski, an act to amend the tax law. 7587 by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the agriculture and markets law. 7730 by Senator Flanagan, an act to amend the real property tax law. 7738A by Senator Farley, an act authorizing. 7769 by Senator L. Krueger, an act to amend the public authorities law. 7830 by Senator C. Krueger, an act to amend the real property law. 7840 by Senator Skelos, an act to amend Chapter 821 of the laws of 1970. 7900 by Senator Savino, an act to amend the workers' compensation law. 7955A by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the agriculture and markets law. 8004 by Senator Aubertine, an act to amend the penal law. 8072A by Senator Schneiderman, an act to amend the general obligations law. 8097 by Senator Squadron, an act to amend the public service law. 8132A by Senator Montgomery, an act to amend the social services law. 8165A by Senator Stuart Cousins, an act to repeal. 8215 by Senator LaValle, an act to amend the highway law. 8229 by Senator Hassel Thompson, an act to amend the executive law. 8258 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the chapter of the laws of 2010. 8289 by Senator Stachowski, an act to amend the penal law. 8310 by Senator Aubertine, an act to amend the public service law. 8333 by Senator Squadron, an act to amend the general business law. 8343 by Senator Foley, an act to amend the environmental conservation law. 8347 by Senator Klein, an act to amend the education law. 8370 by the Senate Committee on Rules, an act to amend Chapter 268 of the laws of 1989. 8373A by Senator Sampson, an act to amend the civil rights law. 8376 by Senator Oppenheimer, an act to amend the education law. 8377A by Senator DeLon, an act to amend the multiple dwelling law. 8378 by Senator Schneiderman, an act to amend the state finance law. 8379A by Senator Schneiderman, an act to amend the labor law. 8391 by Senator Sampson, an act to amend the chapter of the laws of 2010. 5806C by Senator Young, an act to authorize. 7115A by Senator Young, an act to amend the highway law. 7602 by Senator Winter, an act in relation to dissolving. And Senate print 7636 by Senator Winter, an act in relation to dissolving. All bills ordered direct to third reading.
All those in favor of adopting the Rules Committee report, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The Rules Committee report is adopted. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, I believe there's a resolution at the desk by Senator Hassel Thompson. I ask the resolution be read title only and move for its immediate adoption.
Secretary will read.
By Senator Hassel Thompson, legislative resolution applauding and approving the foregoing steps that have been taken by the Chief Judge and the Judiciary to institute an ongoing program with respect to civil legal services in the state of New York.
Senator Klein, is this resolution been deemed privileged by the Office of the Temporary President?
Yes, it has, Mr. President.
Secretary has read. All those in favor of voting in favor of the resolution, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The resolution is adopted. Senator Klein.
Mr. President, is there any further business at the desk?
Senator Klein, the desk is clear.
There being no further business, Mr. President, I move that we adjourn until Wednesday, June 30th at 12 p.m.
There being no further business to come before the Senate, on motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Wednesday, June 30th at 12 p.m.